Hello, I am Jan from Prague, the Czech Republic, and today I want to show you that it's really possible to very quickly master the basics of Affinity, a powerful photo editing program and one of the Photoshop's longtime competitors. Why now? Because the new owner, Canva, has made it completely free for everyone, which is a really big deal for the photography world, as it is a truly professional tool. Let's get started and have some fun. What is really important is not to get lost immediately. So let's make it clear that we have three main sections here: vector, pixel, and layout. And we'll concentrate only on pixel since it's a tool for advanced photo editing. Well, what's worth mentioning is that part Canva AI, which obviously means that you can do a lot of AI tricks here, but it's only for subscribers of Canva. The great part to start is that little thing here. If you touch it and go to panels, you see that that is actually quite important part where you are able to activate what you want to use. So let's do adjustments, quick adjustments, and metadata, for instance. So now we have these three parts here, and you are able to either work with these, for instance, quick adjustments right here, or, which is obviously more convenient, to locate it up here to that part. So now we have quick adjustments, histogram, colors, and all that stuff here. At the same time, please do go to Window, Panels, and find that most important button in your navigation, which is reset. If I hit it, you can see we directly jump back to the default setting. Please do not laugh at this moment, because it's actually what you'll be doing, I can guarantee, because it's, as I said, quite easy to get lost. So once more, adjustments and quick adjustments. That should do for the minute. And we can start playing with what we want to do. So obviously this is the most straightforward way ahead, and you again won't be surprised because this is what you are used to. So we can work with shadows, with saturation, all that very basic but quite important stuff. You can play with clarity, so we can make these clouds to be more visible, more vibrant. I don't think we should spend much time here. What I should mention is the layer. It was here down at the page here, so we hit it, layers. It behaves quite strangely for if you are using Photoshop, but it's not that complicated. You can see that you have all these things here. So it's quite easy to, again, open it, and whatever we've done or whatever we've played with can be again activated here. And we can, for instance, change exposure through that slider here. And of course, if you want to go back, you can hit these little eyes here and you can turn off everything we've done here. And it's very important. Please do not try to skip layers. It is indeed very important part of it. One more example of quick adjustments. We can play with it here or do whatever you want. But if you want to go further, then there are the adjustments which we turned on in the panels. You immediately see that there is so many options here. We can start with levels, for instance, and you can either start manually like I would typically do when I do quick edits, or we can just forget about defaults, and we have so many other options here in these sort of presets, which is quite important. You can play with that, and then you can go inside and do some other edits as you like. But these presets are quite nice. Do not forget, we can go here to layers, turn the level adjustments off, and we are back to the original photos. So please do not forget again that we have these layers here. And I would, as a Photoshop user, always start editing with Ctrl or Command J, which duplicates the layer, so it's easier. And we can again use the adjustments, for instance, and we can try black and white. And you have so many interesting presets here. from which you are able to start. And of course, if you want to start from default or cobalt, you have all these sliders. And it's probably important to mention that if you really want to have a great black and white photo, it's not enough just to turn the color off. You can play and you should play with all these sliders and get exactly what you want. Please do not forget to play with layers and master how it works. One more example and one more way to adjustments. We already have seen quick adjustments, we've seen adjustments as such, and then if we go back here, there is one more option how to turn them on. So if we hit that button, you again see that we have all these amazing things we can turn on here. And I think it's again up to you which of these options would you be using, but take this as an important evidence that of course there are always many ways how to achieve the same effect. So we can try something else, for instance the vibrant, so we can go it more vibrant or less vibrant and play with many of these things. It's quite nice if you get used to these options in adjustments. It's really tempting because you can just start, for instance, with full vibrance and then to do it less aggressive and play with saturation and vibrance and all these things. You can see it does indeed work. Or we might play with levels here so we can slightly adjust this beautiful dog as maybe something like this, and then we decide, okay, now we want to adjust white balance, so we can just see what options we have here. And I have to admit, these results are really not bad at all. So if you are like me, a little bit skeptical about these predefined options, maybe you'll find them quite interesting. And there is important part called history. You can go through all your adjustments one by one, seeing what you've done, what you might be worth revisiting and rechecking. So you can either go through these lines here in the column, or you can touch that slider here and just go there and back and see and decide, okay, I might like it here more, so you can stop here and continue from that point. By the way, we can grab the panel and drag it, for instance, here to this position. So if you need more precise adjustments, you're able to play with them here. But I don't like it here, so I just move it back to the original position. To give you a small break, there is one absolutely fantastic thing, and it's Help. Look at this. They have this option, Ask Ritson, and it's obviously AI assistant, so I can ask him how to reset panels, and he tells me to reset the panels, go to select panels, reset for specific studio you want to reset. This is so amazing. For me, this is one of the most important hidden treasures of Affinity, that you have really working chatbot. And if you are sort of tired by all these basic things, I suggest we can go to another important part, which is the section here. And we have several really amazing tools, including brushes. So let's try, for instance, this one. If I activate adjustment brush tool, here are several options. We are able to tell the program that we want to use brush to change, I don't know, color balance or black and white. So we can try it black and white, because we for some reason might decide we want to make that little thing black and white. So I can paint with a brush over and suddenly it is black and white. Well, I don't really know why should I be doing that. Of course, we can change the size of the brush either with some shortcuts or with this slider here. And you probably would not be surprised that we are able to again fine-tune the options here, and we can decide how exactly would the black and white work in that option. Well, I would not probably be doing that, so do not forget we have that history option, and we can go there and back, or use this slider to decide which of these editing we would be using after all. One more brush, and it's called Inpainting Brush Tool. That would be useful if you decide that you just do not want to have that peacock here. So I take the brush, I can set hardness of the brush, I can make it softer somehow, and then I can paint over that peacock here, and look at this. It's gone. Well, there are some residues here, so we can repeat it once again. So slightly like this, and it's gone. What do you think? You can see what we've done through this history slider, and I'm quite impressed. So there are so many brushes here, and please do try to work with them. The key principles are really very logical. One more brush, which I find extremely useful for many, many years, is called Blemish Removal Tool here. So if I jump back to that example, for instance, and I do it here, and it's gone, or here, and it's gone again. So for me, this is, again, one of the really, really useful things. One more example, Inpainting Brush Tool. We paint over it, and it's gone. Oh, maybe we might not like that little shadow, so we make the brush small again, carefully go, and yeah, perfect. And how about that? This, I don't like this here, so we can paint over it again. And here we go. It's gone. Quite impressive, quite useful. And I'm sure you really like it. So do not forget to check these brushes here. Let me show you one of the really nice features. It's right here in the pixel, filters, lighting. And if I activate this, you'll see what has happened. We have a light source. Let me just move it here, which can be altered. And I am simply able to decide what would be where. And I can manipulate with the shape, I can rotate the shape. And if you ask me, why should I be doing that? Well, I personally would not be doing this, but I have to admit that for me, this is one of the examples of the new generations of the editing softwares. We typically wouldn't be doing this in Photoshop 20 years ago. No, we would not. But, well, more and more I see and enjoy working with these small things. I have to admit, these things open entirely new options. If you are an advanced photographer, of course, one of your questions immediately would be, does this work with RAWs? And, of course, the answer is indeed, it does. And here we go. This is RAW Editor, and I must say I was really impressed because it gives you so many options. Well, in fact, as many options as you need for really advanced editing of RAW files. We can adjust white balance. We can obviously work with the key tools like clarity, contrast, and all that stuff. So if you need RAWs, if you are really advanced photographer, you'll really like even that part. And one more example of what I really like to do on many shots is to use that tool where I am able, look at this, define that I need to make upper part of the sky darker. And it's amazing. And it works again perfectly. So do not hesitate to play with all these things. And you could probably spend weeks and months exploring all these options. But it's not the point. The point is to show you that you should not be afraid to start playing with this. One more dog, quick adjustments. And once you decide you are done, one more quick tip. Do explore that export option. You hit that little thing here and you can go directly to JPEG or any other file you might dream of. It's, look at this, I was quite impressed by all these presets because immediately with one stroke of your finger, you are able to export to TIFF, Photoshop files, PDF, and of course even the different types of HDR files, which is indeed very important. I won't go into details. What I really want to tell you that it will save you a lot of time Of course, advanced options are here, and look at that collection of very different files you are able to use. Of course, I can define that, for instance, I want to make this lovely doc smaller for web presentation, so I just make it smaller to 1500 pixels. So then if I hit export, it'll go to my hard disk. And I'm sure that if you were able to watch up to that point, you already got the message, which is it's really worth trying Affinity because it's amazing software which opens for you really new horizons of photo editing. So thank you so much for your attention. I hope I gave you some inspiration. Take care. I'm Jan from Prague, the Czech Republic.